Good afternoon, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about a new framework to describe woody species abiotic stress tolerance syndromes, particularly useful to integrate such syndromes in large-scale analysis. So niche differentiation in woody species is thought to be limited by biological trade-offs among tolerances toward abiotic stress. So this stems from the classical model proposed by Smith and Houston in 1989, where the authors found that with increasing tolerance of either drought or shade, there is a decreasing maximum growth rate and tolerance combinations are limited by a solid diagonal, above which we cannot find any viable combination of tolerances. But this was a modeling result. So in 2006, there was a test with real world data, and Ninovets and Valadares actually found negative relationships among pairs of tolerances. They also include waterlogging in their analysis. But as you can see, there is still a lot of scatter in these graphs. And also, if we draw the same diagonal as Smith and Houston, we see that roughly half of the species are on the wrong side of the diagonal. Then the authors interpret such discrepancy in terms of species' ability to avoid the constraints imposed by biological trade-off through adaptation. Later on, they proposed that this might depend on an additional dimension, so the duration of the growing season. Basically, they hypothesized that with the increasing length of the growing season, abiotic stresses are less likely to interact, so allowing to the trade-offs to be relaxed. And this is actually what Lannister and Inemet found in 2015, using cold tolerance as a proxy of the duration of the growing season and shade and drought to understand the changes in the shade-drought trade-off. And but as you can see here, there is still a lot of scatter in this graph as well, and trade-off dynamics are still poorly understood. But this result is important because it tells us that probably dealing with abiotic stress data as a multidimensional system can provide new insights on trade-off dynamics. So this here comes the first research question. So how many dimensions do we need to encompass all stress-tolerant combinations exhibited by woody species? So we use the same data set as Lannister and Inemet in 2015 that spans 800 woody species from the Northern Hemisphere. And tolerances toward shade, drought, cold, and waterlogging, where tolerance here means species' ability to survive the long-term shortage of a given resource in their natural environment. What we found is that two dimensions are enough to encapsulate all the stress tolerance combinations across our dataset, and they account for 80% of the variance in the data. The first dimension reflects a trade-off between waterlogging tolerance and drought tolerance, while the second axis is shade tolerance, that is largely independent of the other tolerances. This result was independent of sample sizes and consistent across a subset of the original dataset. After that, we asked which is the trade-off model that is actually generating the combination, stress tolerance combination we observed in the stress tolerance, in what we call the stress tolerance space. So we reviewed the literature to find out the most common trade-off models used. So we found that a correlative trade-off is by far the most used. So tolerance combinations are inferred on the basis of the existence of a negative relationship among tolerances. The boundary line trade-off, so something similar to the Smith and Houston proposition I showed in the first slide. And then we found that the lack of relationship of course as a third choice. So any tolerance combination is equally likely. We found that while the observed stress tolerance space in the red line here in the graph show it's actually differed, slightly different from all the considered surfaces, theoretical surfaces, you can see that the boundary line surface perfectly matches the boundaries of the stress tolerance space and actually includes all the vertexes. So we consider it to be the trade-off model that is generating the stress tolerance combination we observed in the stress tolerance space. So to summarize, we were able to clarify the relationships among multiple abiotic stress tolerances, defining so the major stress tolerance syndromes. And also we were able to identify the limits to stress tolerance combinations, identifying the trade-off model that is generating the observed space. But I would like you to bring home is that this space is actually a map. So a set of coordinates to map other aspects of plant species biology, such as functional traits or range size, within the limits of a biotic stress tolerance of woody species. And for more detail, you can check the original paper with far more discussion on the results. And thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much. Really cool modeling. Let's see if there's any questions in the chat. Probably not yet. That's the problem with these fast talks. But yeah, I have a question on. So you said you used only the two, you selected these two first variables as PC axis or whatever.
Yeah.
Do you get really different? Have you tried with different axis, and do you think you'd get really different results?
Look, we use the Paran test which allows to understand how many dimensions do we actually need to explain the variance in the data. So it searches for basically the minimum number of components that we need to do not get any redundancy in the data. So the results, clearly, it was just the first two components. So that's why we stick with the first two axes. If it's that, it does it through permutation. It kind of generates random data sets for a certain amount of time, and it compares the results to a new model, basically.
That's really cool. Thanks.